Telling you, bro. What's been happening, bro?
Not too much.
Still hitting more Peggy O's.
Hey everybody, welcome to another episode of the Riff Raff. Today I am recording this, San Jose, California, out with Hall & Oates & Train. Just started the tour, summer tour. I don't know if it's summer yet, that's what they're calling it. Anyway, this is actually fun to do in the morning. I'm finishing this podcast with Audley. This was actually recorded in February. But I'm just now getting around to this because I don't do this all the time. A couple of updates. T-shirts, Riff Raff T-shirts. You guys want a Riff Raff T-shirts? You got them. Go to my website. They have them. Very limited. I'm only going to do one run of these things. I don't want to get into the podcast T-shirt business, but they do look cool. What else? I get a lot of emails asking for certain guests and get this guy and this guy. First of all, I appreciate all the comments and all the ratings you guys give me. I like to get people that I know or have some sort of relationship. It keeps the conversation flowing. So I don't know everybody, and some of the people you ask for, I don't know at all. But I do, you know, I do take all of these into consideration. I don't know how much longer I'm going to keep doing these, but got some other great ones coming up after Audley's. So I'm trying to get these done in an expeditious manner as time allows, and I appreciate your patience. But let's get to Audley. My guest today, Mr. Audley Freed. Audley is a badass player. I mean, no doubt. Most of my guests on Riff Raff are. Audley's got vibe and tons of it, and his credits most certainly back this up. I mean, but you know, the thing about Audley, if you know him like I know him, if there was an award for most humble guitar player, Audley would most certainly win this hands down. I mean, he's not a bragger or a name dropper, and he's constantly downplaying his achievements, but it's not in a false, pretentious way. It's a real, genuinely modest way. And you get the feeling that because he came from a small town in North Carolina, he's like really grateful for the opportunities that he's had. And he never thought he'd had the amazing career that he's enjoyed. You'll hear about this. So anyway, he started a band called Cry of Love, which still has tons of fans, and they, you know, yielded a couple of radio hits. He joined a little band called the Black Crows, recorded the legendary Live at the Greek with Jimmy Page. You'll hear about some really great stories that I've been telling for years, so you finally have Audley himself telling these stories. He's currently working with Sheryl Crow and Chris Robinson. I think he's been with Sheryl for 7 years, but he's done just about every cool gig you can imagine. I mean, Joe Perry, Lucinda Williams, Peter Frampton, Dixie Chicks, Wallflowers. He's jammed with, you know, Gavin DeGraw. He recorded Gavin DeGraw's first record. Jammed with the Allman Brothers many times. Grateful Dead. He's a songwriter. He's written with Train, I believe he told me. And, I'll shut up. So here we go. On a cold day in Nashville, I go over to Audley's house. He makes us a couple of really strong cups of coffee. We look through his vinyl collection real quick, and then we get down to business. So hope you enjoy it, and thanks for listening. Yeah, man. All right. Let's do this. So that's my pet peeve, is starting sentences with "so." I hear people on NPR do that, but I'm going to do it. But anyway, man, I'm sitting here in Nashville, Tennessee with my old friend Audley Freed. What's happening, man?
I hadn't seen you in a long time.
It's a long time.
It's good, really good to see you.
I know, man.
Put a smile on. But you can't see us, but we're both grinning from ear to ear, man.
I hope you were honestly grinning, because I know you don't like doing the shit. Well, otherwise you would have told me no.
No, absolutely, man. No, I mean, I didn't hesitate. You know what I mean? Yeah. Especially being you. Then I went back and listened to... I shouldn't say went back, I don't guess, but I listened to a few of the episodes with some people that I know, too. You know,
yeah,
what I mean?
Mutual
and,
friends.
And it's great.
It's legit, man. Come on, it's legit.
Yeah, totally awesome.
But anyway...
I knew this would be fun, and your podcast is really fun to listen to.
Oh,
man.
Thanks, man. Yeah, well, I think a lot of people like to hear you on it. And I there's a lot of things I don't really know about you. I mean, man, the first time I think I met you, I don't know if that place is still there anymore. Was it the Cannery or was some rock club in Nashville? And we were all doing like some benefit jam, and you were playing, and you had that yellow SG. Mm-hmm. And it was backstage, and said hi real quick. Then I don't know how it was a couple of mutual friends, and then we ended up doing this Blue Floyd gig together.
That's what I remember more than anything. I that makes sense that I would have been at the whatever the benefit gig was with that yellow SG that I played a lot of time. I still do, but I would just remember. Where was the first place you showed up, like in Philly or something? I don't know. That whole thing is like a blur to me. It's been a long time.
That's been a long time. I mean, I have this, it's not really a curse, but the unsettling position sometimes to be dropped into situations that are sort of awkward. And that was an awkward one, Floyd thing.
You've got that's because you have the ability to do that. You got the skills to show up on short notice or whatever, you know what I mean? And come in and,
maybe
actually, because
I was available. I don't know, but
no. I heard you tell. Who was it telling the story about you doing that Larry Carlton?
Oh, it was probably Oates. Yeah.
Yeah. Thing on no notice, man. That's incredible. Playing bass. Come on, man. Really playing bass.
I play a lot of bass nowadays. Yeah.
It's good for your guitar playing. It's good for your musicianship. Play bass, isn't it?
I think so. But you know, it's a lot of guitar players overplay bass, but. But anyway,
Ron Wood did, but it was awesome.
It is awesome.
My buddy, I have a drummer here in town. We're talking about Jeff Beck, and he had some bass player on some TV show or something like that. You know what I mean? And somebody was saying, yeah, what about that bass player? It was all over it or whatnot. And he goes, my buddy, the drummer, goes, she ain't no Ron Wood. So we better leave that out. He said, she ain't. Isn't that funny, Greg Morrow? You know Greg.
But
that's impressive to me, man. I mean, it was beyond impressive. I mean, I don't want to interview you, but I am going to ask you some questions during this thing too, because I'm just interested in back. You know, because we kind of share we do a lot of the same things for a living, but I think that our passion for what we do probably is very similar.
Mm-hmm. You know, I remember now the first time I met you, Audley. It was backstage, Minnesota somewhere. You were with the Black Crowes, and you came backstage with Chris Robinson and whoever else was with you at the time.
Were you on that BB King thing?
I was with Art.
I totally remember that. Did you come over to the club?
I don't know if we came over, but I remember you guys coming backstage and talking to Art, and I was standing with Art. I was like,
I wasn't talking to
you were there.
I was there, but I wasn't talking
because we were talking about the meters. And Chris said, I remember this. He goes, man, we were just listening to you guys today on the bus, on the tour bus. And
that's, you got a good memory to remember that. I remember walking across the street because we were playing at First Avenue.
Yeah.
And you guys were at the Target Center, right across the street. I totally remember that. And that was the first time I ever met David, too. Grissom was that day,
right.
too.
That's right.
Because he came over to our sound check.
Now, what was that, like 50 years ago?
Yeah, 56 years ago.
But anyway, man, you know, so.
So that was before at the Cannery or Mercy Lounge.
That was probably a couple of years, before then.
Yeah.
You know, but there's a lot of gaps, like things I don't know about you. Like, obviously, your band, you know, your first band, Cry of Love, you still have, like, a lot of fans, man. That band, you guys caused a lot of waves with that band, man. You know, and I want to talk about that and then into Black Crowes and then, you know, but
right.
Is it Wilmington, North Carolina?
I'm outside of Wilmington. I'm from a little town called Burgaw, North Carolina, 2,000 people. I mean, it was when I was living there. I don't think it's a whole lot more now. And, I mean, just to give you some context, it's in Pender County. It's the county seat. And it used to be, you know, primarily agricultural you know, and that was primarily tobacco farming mostly, yeah. You know, and that's all just kind of gone away, man, you know, and so I think it's become a bit more of a you know, like a bedroom community.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
For people that work in Wilmington or whatnot. Wilmington is a bit larger and is a whole lot larger actually. But yeah, in that area I grew up. I mean, mm-hmm. man, you know, we got to stop. I am not making this up. We got a stoplight when I was 15 years old.
Wow.
In our town. So yeah. It was not a one stoplight. It was a mm-hmm. no stoplight town, you know. And then the Interstate 40 got completed. This all sounds like some Flintstones. You know, then they built the interstate. But it used to only go to Raleigh, all the way from California. And then there was a big gap. And I guess about 1990 or so, they finished the interstate. And one of the exits is an exit in the town. So now there's a McDonald's. There's two stoplights. And there's a McDonald's and all that. But it's very small town. And the rest of the county, you know, there's no towns in.
Wow.
You know what I mean? So it's pretty rural situation. Yeah.
So is that where all you guys like Cry Love, everybody was from there?
No. Those guys were from different parts of the state.
But North Carolina.
Yeah, yeah, North Carolina. Yeah. And we all had played in cover bands, basically, you know, back when there was such a thing. I mean, that's another thing that has kind of gone yeah, the way right. of extinction. You know, but and that's, we all met each other, you know, playing in the same clubs, go, you know, how you have a night off, you go see somebody else's band play and whatnot. But that was kind of the portal for me to, there was a club in Wilmington when I was in college, because I did go to school. I went to college for 4 years and graduated at University of North Carolina in Wilmington. Mm. And there was a club there called the Mad Monk that had bands 4 nights a week or whatever. And my friends and I would, you know, just went probably almost every night. And you end up meeting these guys from these bands that are quote-unquote touring
right.
around, you know, cover bands mostly. And that was the only window that I could see that would maybe lead to being able to play music and get paid to do it and maybe travel a little bit and whatnot, you know. So for me, that was kind of like that was the place that I saw opportunities to play the guitar.
At what age did you know, like, man, I want to be a pro guitar player?
Well, man, I tell you, I don't really know, Shane, to be honest with you, because I never thought that I would be good enough to do it.
Really?
Yeah. You know, even at 19 or, you know, I'd say by the time I was 19 or 20, I maybe... somewhere inside of me, I must have thought that I was good enough to do it, because I did, you know, pursue it. But, you know, where I grew up, man, nobody played. There was only a couple of people around that even played music, and nobody certainly played for a living. There was nowhere to play.
Right.
You know, and so it was not really an option, you know, and the idea of going to Berkeley, or you, did you go to MI?
Did
you
I did.
You know, or doing that, well, there was no MI. Maybe it was existed when this is in the late 70s and early 80s. You know, it was just not something that was on the table mm-hmm. for people in my family.
Right.
And don't get me wrong, I had wonderful family, wonderful people, but it was just not something that was on the radar.
Sure.
You know, so this, you know, going to see these bands in this club was like, you know, to me, that was a window to a whole world of things that I had never experienced, mm-hmm. you know.
So there's always one guy, it seems like, that it's either a teacher or like some guy lives down the street who used to play in a band that was a really good guitar player. Some guy that showed, was there one guy like that? Did you have a person in your life that,
well, you, when I was, yeah, there's to, been a
like
lot of
local through, hero guy, you know?
Yeah. There's been a lot of them through the years, you know, a lot of people that were very influential and on a lot of levels and stuff. But there was a guy and he lived in the next county for me, and his name is Ernie Johnson. I'm still in touch with him. I just talked mm-hmm. to him a couple of weeks ago, and he was a great guitar player, and he had a Les Paul. You know, he had like a, he still has a 72 wow. Sunburst Custom. And he took up a lot of time with me. My dad was quite ill for the better part of about 10 years when I was a kid. And he passed away when I was 18. And so I'm the only child, but my mom had her hands full looking after my dad. And so in a small town like that, you know, people tend to, especially when life sort of revolves around a community and the church and things like that, you know, there were several people that were not just on a musical level, but that kind of were able to take up time that my mom just didn't have.
Right.
But Ernie was a guy who I think saw a little potential in me for whatever reason. And he took up a lot of time with me. And it was really, I mean, it resonates more now than it did even then. Mm-hmm. Because I can see now, you know, I was 15, he was 21.
Mm-hmm.
When I was 21, I didn't want to be spending my time trying to mentor, nurture a 15-year-old kid.
Right,
you know,
right.
I was 21 in college, you know. But he, yeah, he took up a lot. He was a great player.
And what kind of stuff was he showing you, like songs, man, just, or licks and things?
Yeah, and just kind of steered me in different directions. I totally remember one night, man, we were, I had some Kiss. I had Destroyer, I think, and Kiss Alive. And, you know, and he was like, that's cool, you know, but check this out. And I remember, I don't remember the details, but he had this van, this old green and white Ford van, and we drove out into the, somebody had a double wide trailer on a lot out in the woods somewhere, and it was like the benign version of it, just sit here, sit, wait right here, I gotta go see this guy, you know what I mean? It was like the totally within the boundaries of the law version of that. And he came back out and he had this Mountain record called Twin Peaks Live, which is later Mountain album, that there's a version of Rollover Beethoven on there, and something, maybe one other record, seems like, but he had gone to this guy who had these records and borrowed them from him to give to me, and he was like, here, you should check this out, listen to it, you know, listen to this Allman Brothers Fillmore album. And you got to remember, you know, this is late 70s, so this stuff is 5 or 6 years old. It's already ancient.
It's already old, right?
You know,
everybody's your age is listening to Kiss.
You know, and Aerosmith and whatnot, and so, yeah, he did. He pointed me in those directions. He would say, hear that sound, you know, on a record. That's a, that guy's got a Stratocaster with a compressor on it.
Wow.
You know, those kinds of things. And I remember, specifically remember asking him, he had an Ampeg V2 amp, which are, you know, I don't know if you, those things are awesome. Oh. Man, it sounded really, really good. And I remember asking, I was like, what is this knob? It says mid range on here, you know.
Yeah.
So things of that nature,
right?
You know, and
that's huge, man.
And then we would go jam out in his outbuilding, and he had a 4-track recorder. He would tape it and give me a copy of it, and I'd go back to work at the grocery store and unmercifully make people that I work with listen to this jam we did last night. You know, so it was huge, man. Yeah, it gave me a lot of confidence, I think. You know, like I said, it means more to me now because contextually I can see how valuable his time was.
There's always somebody like that. For me, it was my uncle, you know, and then there were other music people later, but yeah, it's important. Like people don't realize, man, you can push somebody a certain direction just by the things you say when you're a kid, man. You're so easy. You're so open.
Right.
And even though you don't realize it, and then later on, and it can go the opposite way. You could discourage somebody too. Some mean shit. And
absolutely. You know, you're really, really hitting the nail on the head there. And, you know, there have been a lot of people through the years, Shane, lots and lots, too many to name because inevitably I'll leave somebody out.
Yeah.
You know, I don't want it. But he was the first one.
He was the first one in your town or nearby.
And maybe looms as large as anybody.
Mm-hmm.
You know.
That's
lovely guy. Wonderful guy.
I always ask that question. It's just different for everybody. Everybody has their... You know, you're telling me about him. For me, it was my uncle. For Dweezil Zappa, it was Eddie Van Halen. We'd come to his house.
Right.
You know, we all didn't have that luxury.
We weren't getting that. Yeah. Well, and I heard you ask Porter, you know, George Porter, like, who's your favorite baseball
player? Right.
You know, and he mentioned a couple of dudes.
He mentioned
from the
some clubs. Guys that are lost to history, man. You know, I hear those names all the time from Mac or from Art Neville. You know, just like, nobody's ever heard of these cats, and that means more to me. Like, wow, that's really pure.
Absolutely, man. Absolutely, yeah.
Well, let's talk. All right, so you put this band together, Cry Love, North Carolina, and you guys are, I mean, how did it all come together with the record deal, like the short version, like you just, the normal story where you're like, did you do a showcase or something for a label?
Well, kind of. I mean, to back up just a little bit, we had all been playing in these cover bands, and Robert Kearns, the bass player who plays in the Sheryl Crow band with me now still, he's like as close to family as, I'm not even going to say that, he is family to me, you know. We were both playing in the same band, and I was just like, you know, this is like not, we're just driving around the Southeast playing at frat parties on the weekend, and we're not making any money.
Yeah, it's not going to go anywhere.
And I had been in another cover band before that, and I was really didn't make any money. I mean, and not that that's what it's about, but I'm talking about like $10 a day.
Yeah.
You know, and five dudes in a hotel room are playing six nights a week, four sets a night. You know, I look back now and realize, boy, that was really good for me to do that, mm-hmm. you know. So it became pretty evident, you know, hey, I'm not moving forward doing this, you know. We're just kind of comfortably traveling around, and 6 months have gone by.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So I said, you know, I said, let's, I'm going to go get a day job, and we'll find a rehearsal space, and, you know, let's just try our hand and see what happens, you know? So it was me and him, and Jason Patterson was a drummer, and we started, and, you know, I put about 9 years of my life into that, mm-hmm. like 100 full bore.
Label interest and all that stuff, and then you got your...
Yeah, sure did. We got a deal with Columbia Records in like 1992,
mm-hmm.
I guess. You know, we had been through a couple of singers. The core guys were always me and Jason and Robert. And we had done a quote-unquote a demo. We'd been recording some demos at a studio there in Raleigh with a friend of ours named John Custer, who was ended up producing our record. And we had one that had a couple songs on it, but it wasn't finished.
Mm-hmm.
And a friend of mine, in fact, he's a New Orleans guy, Pepper Keenan, mm-hmm. Was going out on a tour and was like, man, let me just have something to listen to or whatnot. And I was like, okay, man, but just don't play it for anybody. We're not even done. We might put a couple overdubs on it and mix it and whatnot. Well, sure enough, he went and played it for this guy at the label. Josh Sarban was our A&R person. And you know, next thing I know,
wow,
you know, he said, I want to come down and see your band. And so he came down to see the band and, you know, it happened. You know, it's one of those things where I think you just have this kind of blind faith, but at the same time, you don't think that it's ever going to happen. Because for a guy like me, I don't know about you, for yourself, it'd be interesting to know, since you grew up around the, you know, some music and around a bit of a music industry. But to me, that was always seemed like that there, it was just, everything was like behind, mm-hmm. it was like the Wizard of Oz.
Yeah.
It was all behind a curtain. And
well, the whole business thing is like that. I mean, you could grow up around all kinds of stuff, music-wise, but the business is a totally different thing. The industry is a better, you know what I mean? If there's no industry, that the way that works is like Wizard of Oz behind the curtain thing,
mm-hmm.
that whole machinery, you know.
But just the idea of, quote-unquote, getting a record deal, you know, that didn't happen to mortal. It was like a comic
book. Right.
You know what I mean? It didn't happen to mortal people, so...
So did you guys, you recorded that record in North Carolina?
In Muscle Shoals, Alabama. Well,
I didn't know that.
Mm-hmm.
I was going to ask you where he was recording.
At the studio that is no longer there.
Fame?
No, it was at Muscle Shoals Sound.
Muscle Shoals Sound.
Which was the second location of Muscle. Did you ever work down there?
No, I never got to work there, but I know a little bit about
it. It was down on the river, and
cats,
then they
yeah.
moved, because, you know, the original one where they cut Wild Horses and you know, Rod Stewart and
That was Rick Hall,
Paul Simon,
place,
and all that. No, that wasn't at Fame. That was actually at Muscle Shoals Sound.
Oh, okay.
Which was a different studio, and then they built a bigger one down on the river. And you know, I don't know all the details. I know some guys that do that are from down there. Mm-hmm. But yeah, we did it down there.
Wow, yeah. Man, I'm trying to think. That I remember that video was the song.
Peace Pipe.
So Peace Pipe. Called,
right? Yeah.
The video is like the. I want to ask you because I watched it the other day again and. The pool table and all that scene, you know, that bar.
I think that was across the street from our rehearsal space.
In North Carolina?
Yeah, and I can't remember the name. I want to say the name of that place was Fanny's or something like that.
Because there's that guy, Annie's that like the old dude by the pool table, he's like shooting pool.
Man, stuff. I haven't seen it in years.
It's a great video.
I can't remember. But that, I think that's where that was. It was like a, you know, what you call an old man bar. I mean, it was literally
so
a real
there with cameras and shot
old
a video.
Man bar. Yeah. I'm that's the best I can remember. You know, somebody's probably going to be like, no, it's not where it was.
Yeah.
You know. But I think that's where that was, yeah. It was right across the street because we used to rehearse in this basement of an office building, you know, slanted floor, being there with 100-watt Marshalls on, you know, on six, no earplugs.
Oh, man.
Yeah, ridiculous. Hey,
what gear were you using on? I usually don't talk about this, but I know you always have killer amps and stuff. So on the Cry Love record, a Marshall? Was that a
Marshall? It was an old 7,300-watt Marshall, man. And a Marshall cabinet, I guess it had 25 watts.
You
I don't
just
even
turn
know.
It all the way up. And
no, I didn't. I turned it up on best I can remember, probably about halfway. You know, it was a little cleaner. You know, I didn't. Yeah. You know, but yeah. And I can't, man, dude. I worked in a music store, and you know, anytime anybody would bring an old amp like that in that had Marshall written on it, you know, back then I think I bought that thing for $200.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and then got somebody to put some tubes in it. I remember, I think it did have a 6550 tubes rather than EL34s, which I'm not really sure what that does. But I can't say that I had tweaked it and refined it.
Right.
You know, I had two or three of these things. I never used them because they were so loud, you know.
Yeah.
It just was the best sounding one coming through the microphone. I think I brought a couple of them down there.
That's a great sound on that stuff, man.
Well, thanks, man. I mean, I can't take any credit for having dialed it all in beforehand.
There's probably tape too down there, right?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, that was before. I guess Pro Tools was probably around, but we didn't.
Yeah. That was probably ADATS or something back then. I don't know.
Yeah.
Burn down the sacred ground. Temple down. In the name.
Riff to a Peace Pipe.
Yeah.
I wanted to. So, this is the riff to.
Let me see if I can remember.
I remember that song. And I remember the great guitar sound on there.
Man, I can tell you a little story about that, too.
Yes, please.
I used to work at a guitar shop, at Harry's Guitar Shop, which is a great. Still, it's in Raleigh.
Still open?
Still open, yeah.
All
great.
Right, cool.
Great place.
We'll have to check it out.
A lot of cool people. And one Friday, I was unboxing some, you know, the UPS guys show up, you know, with new stuff. It was always the exciting part of the day, you know, and unboxed the guitar and just played that on the guitar that day in the store, you know, and not even through an amp or anything. I have no idea what guitar, I can't remember. I don't know why I remember that it was a Friday, you know, but, and the whole thing just kind of came into my head. You know, I could kind of hear the ensemble playing. Oh, if I play this, then
we
can put this around it. And that has not really ever happened to me very much in my whole life. You know what I mean? But it's just a B chord on a Telecaster. It sounds kind of weird, but let me see if I can do it without missing. Man, and it's basically just a B chord, but with a dominant flat 7 or the 1 and the 5.
Yeah.
And so if you count it as 1, 2, 3, 4, 1. That's all it is.
That's great.
So it's not on the downbeat. 3, 4, 1.
Yeah.
But you know, you hear you.
That's what
hear,
makes it so hooky.
Well, and yet again, we were just talking about the space and the. You know, that's a hard lesson to learn, man. Dude, believe me. You know, I have played a lot of notes in my time.
Mm-hmm.
and I have played way too much. I was really trying to write some simpler stuff that wasn't just guitar-y, mm-hmm. you know, and that was sort of at the beginning of that period of me trying to edit myself, not only as a lead guitar player, but as a riff writer and songwriter too. So yeah, it's really, so I guess it is kind of, I never really thought about how simple that is, but it kind of
very
is.
Hooky though. That's the trick, is to write something simple that's really cool.
Like, yeah. And yeah, that's it.
There was another tune I saw you do on YouTube when I was checking out. It was kind of a Hendrix-y, yeah.
That Highway Jones thing?
Highway Jones. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, that thing. That's a C sharp standard. My buddy.
That's a pretty what do you...
Well, it's just a, man, you know, if that's a C sharp. That's it.
There you go. Yeah, man.
Yeah.
I like the C sharp on
the guitar. C sharp minor. Yeah.
You can go that thing.
Oh yeah, yeah.
The tax man.
Thing. Yeah. Is that how he? Is it? Yeah, yeah. So you're playing minor, and you're playing seven sharp.
Yeah, it's a cluster.
Yeah. I'm just playing that straight. The Spanish Castle Magic one. And the part where the chorus of that, the quote unquote chorus, really is kind of a turnaround or whatnot. It was just. I think so. That's another example of just trying to make it, you know, really simple. And that's really just what Ron Wood plays in "I'm Losing You," the Temptation song by the Faces.
It?
You know, when he goes.
Wow.
It's just that backwards. Just grabbing a handful of notes.
Yeah. You know.
But if you get that six and that. That's just a Motown chord, isn't it?
Yeah, it's all that sus.
Yeah. But this being the root, though.
Yeah, it's a sus thing.
Simple, dumb.
That's super, great, man. It's great shit.
Dumb. Yeah. Yeah. I like dumb. Yeah.
Skipping forward, like Cry Love into Black Crowes. I mean, I'm guessing Cry Love broke up, and then how did Black Crowes? You just knew those cats. They knew the
no,
band.
No, I did not know them, but I will say that I think a couple of people in North Carolina that did know them, they had a vacancy in their lead guitar department. Like this is like 1997, something like that. And
after Mark IV,
this is his. Yeah, that was his chair. Yeah. And so I think it really I found out that a couple of guys that I knew, and they weren't really like I wasn't really close to them. They were just people that I would see socially and play, you know, at gigs and whatnot. Had called Chris Robinson and recommended me for this gig before I was, you know, because I knew that the position was open, and I thought, man, I sure would love to try to get a shot at doing that because I really, really like that band.
Right,
a lot,
perfect,
you know?
Fit. Yeah,
yeah, and I thought that it would be a good fit, and I was just a real fan, man. You know, coming from where I come from, as a '70s rock and roll kid, you know, it was the idea of playing that music was very appealing to me, and so I was going to try to pursue it anyway, but you know, as luck would have it, I think now that's the best I can remember, Shane. I think a couple of these guys had recommended me, and then their label all of a sudden was Columbia, which was the same label that Cry of Love had been on, so I knew a couple of people at the label, and I said, hey, can you put in a word for me if they're going to audition people?
Yeah,
and
cool. So, wow.
And that's what happened. I mean, I think they looked at a few guys.
Now, did you have to audition? Or you
that's
just
what
showed
I'm
them?
Saying, yeah. Yeah, I went down and
they gave you songs to
they
learn.
They gave me about 9 songs to learn, and just kind of out of the blue, you know, this phone call.
That's the way this stuff happens a lot of times,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, it was weird. Yeah. And it was like, can you come down here Friday? So, man, I had an old Nissan straight shift pickup truck, man. And I put my amp head in there, my guitar, and drove to Atlanta. Got there the night before and went and did the audition. We did about eight of the 9 songs. And they're like, well, man, if you get out of here now, it's Friday. You know, you can beat the Travis 3:30. You can beat the traffic. You know, and I was like, oh, man.
Are we going to play tomorrow?
We didn't even play the other song. You know what I mean? But luckily, it was the inverse of what it could have been, that they actually had heard enough to know, okay, this guy can play. But that was like in October, I think. And I didn't end up starting like working with them until like June.
Wow.
Because they were in the middle of making a record, you know, and so they were getting ready to start touring like the following June. So I spent a lot of months in like a limbo of like, man, I wonder, you know, if I'm going to,
you've kind of moved on in your head.
Yeah. Almost. Yeah, exactly. You know, and I was also adjusting my thinking, you know, to thinking about going out and getting work, which, you know,
Sideman.
Yeah. We had been talking earlier about, you know, a lot of, you know, guys that play in bands their whole life, you know, that's just where your head is at.
Right.
You know, and I was kind of switching gears in my brain as far as that goes, you know, so, but it did end up happening.
I mean, now you've done, I don't know all the, which records you played on Black Crowes.
Man, really only, I played on a 3 or 4 songs on a record called Lions.
Yeah.
That they made. And then.
And you're Live at the Greek for sure.
Live at the Greek, I started to say the Hendrix one,
yeah.
the Jimmy Page one. And then they after the band split up, there was a live album that came out that I'm on.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You got any favorite tracks? Because I'm about to ask you Jimmy Page stories before that.
Any favorite tracks,
like,
man?
You know, stuff you've...
Well, I didn't really play on that much of stuff.
Well, the stuff you did, like the live stuff. I mean, any of the songs you really like playing a lot?
Man, I liked playing a lot of those songs a lot because there's a whole lot of really good ones.
Yeah, I know. That's some great stuff.
Then as it was, then again it will be. Though the course may change sometimes, rivers always reach the sea.
You know, honestly, man, you know how this is. I don't know if this is the same way it is for you, but it's been so long.
Yeah.
And I don't
Well, you've done so many gigs
well,
since
Well, the other
then,
thing
man.
Is, too, is I don't, yeah. you know, I don't sit around my house and go, hey, I think I'll
no,
listen
I
to this.
No, I know you don't. Obviously, no, absolutely.
So sometimes I can't remember,
yeah.
man.
You I know? Mean, just people know you for all the cool gigs you've done, and Black Crowes is definitely one of them.
Yeah,
know?
There was a lot about it that was interesting. Too, you know what I mean.
Now you've told me these stories, and I, you know, you don't have to tell them all if you don't want to. But man, you got to tell me at least one or two of the Jimmy Page stories. I remember the whatever
yeah,
that is,
yeah, yeah,
that,
yeah.
that story, and the
you know,
the Haagen-Dazs story.
Yeah,
you know,
that's pretty crazy.
If you
too,
don't
man.
Mind sharing a few of those, they're
no, absolutely not, man. Absolutely
legendary.
Not.
This folks is why I do this. This like these stories.
And I'll be the first one to say that my memory is not the greatest, you know. But I don't think that I'm embellishing any of this or making any of it up. I'm probably leaving
matter.
Some things out.
It's even better,
you know what I mean?
Dude. It doesn't matter.
But, man, the first one that I can think of is that when we were going to play our first show with him, which was a charity show at a little club in London, that was going to be on a Sunday. If I remember this correctly, that was going to be on a Sunday. And on the Friday before that, we were going to rehearse with him, you know. So,
now, sorry, real quick. I'll just give him a little context. So Jimmy Page joined the Black Crowes for a tour, right?
Yeah, but this is way before that.
Oh, okay.
This is what initially sparked. Now, this is, you know, what I understand happened. You know, not being like a principal member of the group and speaking with management about it and everything. Yeah, yeah. You know, I think this is what got filtered down to me. But I think this is correct. That we did this charity gig, and the charity gig went real well. And it turned into, well, let's just do some shows mm-hmm. after that. You know, I think it was the following year. So here we go on Friday afternoon. Well, I've known that we're going to do this for like 5 or 6 weeks. You know, so you can imagine I've worked myself up into like a, you know, you can imagine I've just worked myself up thinking about I've got to go play guitar with Jimmy, you know. Right. And so we get to the rehearsal space, and we had been doing a little bit of Whole Lot of Love in the middle of a jam in one of the songs. Chris tells Jimmy that, and he was like, well, all right. He goes, well, let me see how you do it. And so he sat down on the couch literally as far as you are to me right now, and I had to go bonk, bonk, and play the wah-wah thing in front of him.
Talk about pressure.
But, you know, I mean, I've done it 1,000,000,000 times ever since I was a kid.
But not with Jimmy Page watching.
But not with him sitting right there, you know. And so once we got past that, it was like, okay, you know.
Right.
Because I thought that we were going to go in. I didn't, you know, and rehearse with him. I didn't know that he was going to sit out there, you know, like we're at the Rock Olympics.
Right,
you know what I mean? And so once we got past that, I was like, I specifically remember that moment. And so we did that club gig. Yeah, and then it turned into some things. I'll tell you one. We were rehearsing in New York, and I kind of was I had gone through, it's been a long time. It's like, you know, we've all heard these records a million times or whatnot. But, I wanted to make sure that when we showed up at the rehearsal that we put the time in.
Yeah, to learn the parts.
And learn, you know, I mean, hey, how many times have you gone in to do something, especially when you're in a house band or at, you know, you do that every week. I see you on TV, you know, or for part of the year or whatnot. But how many times just in any given situation do people show up and they're not only like unprepared, they're like not prepared at all.
Right, right. You know, more than people would think. Actually.
More than people would think, right?
Yeah, you know?
And so I was like, I got too much respect for this guy and this music and all that he has given me, you know, because I had a poster on, you know, 77 sure. tour poster on my wall when I'm a kid. You know, I still got it in there.
Dragon Pants and Zoso and all
yeah,
that.
Yeah, yeah, man. The Dragon Pants or the one with the yellow sunglasses and the Nazi SS hat. Remember that? And, I was just, you know, I wanted to make sure that we were going to show that respect by doing a good job, being
right.
prepared. You
right,
know?
Right.
So I did a lot of prep work. Like I said, you think you know these songs and you go back and listen to them and you're like, whoa,
there's
man.
Layers of shit.
And
going
what's
on,
going yeah. on there? Like there's a part in the ocean where there's a, where the, that.
Wow.
That thing in the middle.
It's doing that.
But there's one, I best I can figure it, man. I think there's a dominant tritone in there. And I think there's a major seven on top of it.
Wow.
Like a, or something. I can't really hear it. But yeah. you know, when you yeah. start digging into it.
Yeah.
You start hearing these things. So we learned all the stuff, and we were going over 10 Years Gone, you know, which uh-huh. in the middle of it, there's 5 guitars in one part of the song.
Wow.
Know? And there's a harmony, which I'm not going to even attempt to remember how that goes right now. But he came up to me, and he was like, now, what would be my part on this song? And I said, well, Jimmy, I think it's this. And I went, meeny, 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 you know, yeah. whatever that is. And he and this is my part, and I said, let's try it, and you know, so we count 4 and we play it, and it's all cool and everything. And I said, does that sound right? And he goes, well, that sounds good. So I was like, okay, right, okay, yeah, you know, yeah. So we did all those shows. It was electric, man. The first night that we played at the Roseland in New York, which is no longer there. Did you ever play there?
No,
Roseland.
Never
you know,
did.
It was across the
yeah.
street from the Ed Sullivan Theater. And I think the first song was Celebration Day, you know, and I just remember looking over at the dude like on the downbeat. You know, and I was like, what is happening right now?
Surreal.
You know, which was, it's almost so, and you've played with a lot of your heroes, man. Not just famous people. I'm talking about people that, who you admire, you know what I mean? And you know, he kind of inhabits both of those spaces.
Oh, that's a huge one, man.
But I'm just saying, it's so surreal that I'm not sure that I'll ever really be able to, like, put it into context, you know, especially from where I come from, you know, like, how did this happen to me? You want to hear? There's
I'm waiting for the story. I know the stories. I just want you to tell them again. The Cool in the Gang one is a pretty good one.
Yeah. You think we should go public with that? I don't know.
Well, it's not whatever. If you don't want to tell it, I think it's harmless. But it's
yeah. So we did a run of shows, and then the next year we're going to do another tour. And I think we did that live at the Greek thing, like in the first initial six shows that we played or something. And then like the next summer we're going to do, so we were in Chicago rehearsing for that. And, Jimmy came in one day. I guess I can call him Jimmy. He's his first name, basically. Mr. Page came in one day.
Pagey.
Yeah. With his, bodyguard guy, and says, I don't know. Do you think that I should tell?
Hell yeah. I think you should.
That, like, he, is it like not?
Oh man, it's great. Much? No, it's, you know. What are you thinking? I mean, I doubt if Jimmy Page is listening to this, and even if he was, it's harmless. I mean, it's what happens. Funny. I think it's cool actually that he would even be that hip to.
Yeah, yeah. So he came walking in one day. We were rehearsing, and this is the way I remember it. He comes walking straight up to me. And he goes, Audley, this is a horrible accent. In fact, I won't even try to do the accent. But he goes, can you show me how to play Celebration by Cool in the Gang? I've just heard it on the radio, and it's fantastic. That was the word that he used. Fantastic. Well, of course, I have no idea how to play it. I'm sure you can play it, right? You know how to play it?
I know the song.
And it's
I've
awesome.
I've never played it in my life.
It's
yeah.
awesome.
It's R&B like a little guitar. Octave thing.
Yeah. And there's another one. Thing happening in the background, but you know, all I know is I said, Jimmy, I think it goes like this. And he looks at me and just has this big grin on his face, and he goes, woohoo, like that. Or that's the best I can remember it.
Oh, it's so
but
good,
I was
man.
Like, man, what just what
so, yeah
just
dragon
happened? But I just thought it was so charming and awesome. A, that he even still listened to the radio,
yeah.
You know, and that he was like super into that.
Yeah,
you know?
He's in the hooky stuff. It's a hook, you know.
You know, and so that says a lot.
Yeah, but it's a great story.
But it's a twilight.
And I love the way you say, like, you know, there were several people around, and they all have the cores. It's sort of like the Bible. It's like the New Testament. Yeah. We think this is what happened. You know, everybody was around. But I like the other one too. You told me one time about. I don't know, there's a few. You probably don't want to tell them. But there was the dressing room Kroger deli tray one. There was the you don't have to tell that one. And then there was the Haagen-Dazs one.
Yeah, we were in Chicago yet again, and we were going somewhere, maybe to a music store or something. And this, we passed like a Ben & Jerry's or a Haagen-Dazs. I can't remember whichever one it was, you know. And he commented on that. He was like, I've heard that Ben & Jerry's has been bought out by Haagen-Dazs or something like that. And I was sitting in the back seat of this vehicle going, that's the guy that was on my wall in that dragon suit talking about ice cream.
He's worried about ice cream.
Yeah, that's, you know, he's just a guy that talks about things that happen in the world, you know. Because, you know, when you're a kid, you paint these pictures of dudes living up on a hill in a castle with servants.
Aleister Crowley's castle.
Yeah, you know, like he's never seen a TV or something. You know what I mean? Like,
Jason Bonham told me that when he played with them for the reunion, you know, Jason was like 19. He's just partying his ass off and, you know, trying to be like his dad, you know. And he's backstage and he told me this, man, straight from the source. He said, Robert Plant and Jimmy Page and John Paul Jones are sitting on a couch. They're like reading. One guy's got a magazine, they're reading like a newspaper. And he's like, could I use your reading glasses? And then it was like this old lady who used to make food for him back in the Zeppelin days. She was still alive. And,
right.
and she's like, Pagey, I made you sausages just like you like them and wrapped them just for later, you know. And he's like, what the fuck is this? Right? We'll just throw some TVs out the window, you know.
Yeah.
He's like,
yeah.
what the hell is this?
Reading.
And he said when they were rehearsed. This he had a, this is like a few years later, they were doing some rehearsals, and he had like one of their original cell phones that you could actually record stuff on. So he's like on his phone all the time, but he's pressing it. And Jimmy Page, or one of them, was look at him and go, are you on your phone again? And he goes, I'm recording the what we just did, you know? And he looks at Robert Plant, Jimmy Page, and he goes, he said he's recording on his phone. And they're laughing at him. So that's just Led Zeppelin, man.
But, that is so awesome, yeah. man. I got to play with John Paul Jones, too.
And I remember that. Yeah, that was
at,
a while back.
At
yeah,
101 Haynes' Christmas jams. Wow. And Cry of Love toured with Robert Plant. We opened for him a bunch of shows, but he hated us.
Really?
But we were still there.
Why did he hate you?
I don't know. You know. But we were still there, so... The three surviving guys.
Yeah, you know, man. You've been in the, be weird. Yeah, you've hung with all of them.
Of course, Robert Plant spent a lot of time here in Nashville a few mm-hmm. years back. You know, in fact, I know some guys played with him.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, he said he was going to be on Daryl's show. We did a show with Daryl. Hall & Oates did a thing with Robert Plant a couple year ago, and he was hanging out backstage. He actually went up to Daryl. He goes, "Hi, Daryl." And Daryl goes, hey, why don't you come on my show? He goes, you have a show? Yeah. And he goes, well, I'm really hard to get in touch with. I live on the, you know, in Wales. I don't have any phone or TV or any. You know.
Right. Wow.
But anyway, he said he would do it. But.
That's, yeah, yeah.
Do you ever see that thing, man? Like, whole, you know, it's real quick, I would talk about this. Like the Jimmy Page parts, you said you had to learn, man. They're deceptively simple, but they're not really simple. They're really layered, and like there's a lot of shit going on. It's simple.
Yeah,
it seems simple, but like, you know, a whole lot of love, like everybody goes or whatever it is, something mm-hmm. like that. I was watching this thing with Steve Stevens, right? And
right.
he said this is the way Jimmy played it, and it's like a little simple thing where you hit this unit, like these notes together, and you slightly bend this and it goes right.
That sounds exactly like it.
But yeah. the way he does it through Marshall.
Yeah.
You know, it gives you that little dissonance.
It makes it speak.
It's totally different.
You know?
And there was another one that was where he...
Yeah, now that does happen at the end of Black Dog.
Yeah, all that stuff. Yeah, all those little simple things.
Yeah, I got a lot of, man. I mean, you know, this is the kind of thing where you go back and hear some music that you haven't listened to in a long time. Because, I mean, face it, I don't really sit around the house and put on Led Zeppelin mm-hmm. 4, you
sure,
know,
yeah.
and listen to it because I've heard it so much. But sometimes when you do, you know, I really have. Does it ever happen to you? I have these revelations of like, man, I got a lot of stuff. I learned a lot
from these
guys. Or not just Led Zeppelin, whatever.
Well, sometimes it's not a conscious thing where you sit down and shed stuff. Sometimes it's just osmosis. Like, you're actually touring with Jimmy Page or all these great artists. So a lot of things, man, it's you think it's automatic pilot, and then a few years later you might go, oh, yeah, I soaked all this stuff I wasn't even thinking about. It's
right.
like George, you know, you were saying you listened to that George Porter episode of my thing, and he's talking about Sissy Strut.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah, yeah.
You play, and he goes, no, it's not that.
I know. There was one note
it's
out
totally
of place.
Different,
yeah,
man.
Yeah.
It's like, you don't put, it's not 4 tablespoons of sugar, it's 1. It makes
right.
a totally different taste.
Yeah, you know, and you know those nuances, man. Do you think, I mean, make all the difference in the world as far as, I think that's one of the key ingredients for people speaking with an individual voice as far as an instrumentalist goes, don't you think?
Absolutely.
I mean, you know,
especially what we do, because you know, you think about the guitar, man, there's like a piano, you know, you have to hit the key, then the hammer has to hit the string,
right,
and this or that, and it's your identity gets a little more buried, so you
mm-hmm.
maybe your identity will come out like harmonically in a chord or something. But the guitar, man, it's totally naked.
Yeah.
It's our fingertip against a piece of wire. And every touch and every nuance, like you said, that's how you know it's Santana or whoever, or Jeff Beck or you, Audley, or whoever. Everybody has their fingerprint.
Well, I think that some guys more than others, too. Don't you think?
Sure.
I mean, you know, you could name quite a few, but you know, when you pick them out of a lineup.
Well, who are some of your, I kind of skipped over that, but who are some of your guys that you liked growing up that you listened to that you maybe got into?
Man, I was a, you know, I was a 70s radio guy. So it was kind of all over the place. You know, I never, Shane, I never focused, I never got so, as they say where I come from, like eaten up with one guy that I really honed in on a single player's thing, right. You know. But the, it was just, you know, whatever was on FM radio at the time, a lot of it, to be honest with you, you know. And what is called classic rock now, you know. And a lot of that, you know, the standards and a lot of what would be like more obscure now almost, you mm-hmm. know, in a weird way. But that was kind of it, you know. I didn't play any jazz. Mm-hmm. You know, the blues that I played was filtered through, you know, the classic rock thing, mm-hmm. you know. And then once I got in college, you know, I would go out and see players. I had an opportunity to, you know, to go out to nightclubs and see guys play. And so that would, there was two or three of those guys that were really influential on me when they would come through and I would see them. So, I can't say that I, you know, spent a year shedding one person's
right
thing, you know, and a lot of it was access at the time, you know. I would wait every month and see if the new Cream or Circus magazine showed up down at the Scotchman, which was the convenience store, mm-hmm. you know, and, you know, if you could see somebody on the Midnight Special, you know, which was a TV show that came mm-hmm. on Friday nights, you know, but mostly it was radio, you know, I would just hear things on the radio and somehow, I don't know, you know, ended up like with Robin Trower, Bridge of Sighs album, man. Like, you know,
yeah.
It was, maybe I'd heard a little bit of it on the radio or something, but you know, there was four or five people that were really into music, like in where I went to school and in my neighborhood. Somehow the information would get kind of passed around that way. You know, I think about that now and it's all a little bit of a mystery to me. Like, how was I aware of some of these things? You know,
This comes up a lot with some of my guests. You know, we talk about why did we do it before YouTube? You know, I think it was actually better because it forces you to pay attention more and focus more. And
don't you think that, yeah, and inside of that, I mean, like for your ear, I don't really have, I never had any formal ear training, and my ear is not the greatest for sure. I'm not being, you know, self-effacing by saying that. It's just not a gift that I have or have ever really developed. But you know, you develop an ear on your instrument just by doing it, even without knowing it. But if you got to learn a song, you know, sometimes if you have to hear it and figure it out by hearing it rather than watching somebody show it to you.
Yeah, absolutely.
You know, don't you think that in the long run?
Yeah, it's like using a GPS versus like driving exactly, around getting lost for a while. Then you actually know it. You know?
Yeah, that's exactly what it is. Mm-hmm. You know, it's funny, man. Now too, it's enough time has passed that, you know, I mean, I literally grew up, you know, moving the needle back on records. And you know, now I know that sounds to younger people like it sounded to me when somebody would tell a story about, well, this guy walked 12 miles.
Yeah, right, you know, right. And in my day, we didn't have
But it has really come to that. You
it's
know?
True. Still the best way. I mean, now you can get, you know, like a slow downer app thing and you can put something in, you can slow it down and learn it. But by ear is still the best way, man.
Yeah, I think so, you know, especially like if you're, well, no, in all cases. But, man, if you do develop your ear enough to be able to use the tricks that your mind has, you know, the methodology to hear a complicated mm-hmm. passage, and you can, you know, break it down. You know, you know what I'm saying? You can use these methods that you develop in your own brain for parsing that out just a little bit at the time. You know, if you're able to do that, that's a really good skill to have.
Yeah. You played on a Robin Ford record, rhythm guitar,
right? Yeah, sure
right?
did. Yes, I played rhythm guitar.
Well, no, I think I remember you telling me I played rhythm. That's why I said that.
You played with him?
No, I never have.
You haven't?
Nope. Never have.
Oh, no, that, yeah.
Why would I play with Robin
Ford? Is that called a rhetorical? What's the thing?
What was
same
that,
thing,
what was
man.
It like? I mean, playing, I mean, because you're a great rhythm player, too. I'm not surprised.
No, man, I had met him at one of Warren Haynes' Christmas Jam things, and he was really nice and said some complimentary things to me, you know. Mm-hmm. which I always just take with a whole shaker of salt. You know what I mean? Because the guys are so accomplished, man, and they.
Those cats don't dish out just any compliments.
But they also, you know, they walk with giants, man. You know, I mean, playing Miles Davis and these things. You've hung around with. I'm sure that Schofield has told you all kinds of stories. You know, but he was really nice, and I think also too, man, that they some of those guys, like his affinity, like I think Robin's affinity for like rock and roll, like came really really late. Mm-hmm. I'm not sure that he really. Like, he told me, he was like, I heard Led Zeppelin and Rolling Stones, it sounded like a bunch of noise.
Wow.
You know, he was like, I was listening to Aretha Franklin and Otis Redding, like the real R&B, you know.
Yeah.
He was like, it was much later in life when I really began to kind of understand this.
Right, you know? Right.
So, yeah, man, he just called me up out of the blue a few years ago and said, hey, I'm going to be making this record in Nashville. We're going to cut the whole thing in a day.
Wow. Old school.
And I told him, I said, man, you know, if it's going to be some heavy changes and some deep stuff, you know, I'm not your guy to do. That's just not what I do, you know, and I don't want to waste your time and embarrass myself. And he was like, no, it's going to be fine. Don't worry. And so kind of the same thing with the Larry Carlton thing. I showed up for the rehearsal. We had done a Sheryl gig, and I flew back in on Sunday and went straight over to this rehearsal. And he was like, I got charts, you know, and then it turned out, of course, there weren't for some of these tunes. And then there were, but they were all written like in notation, you know, and I was like, oh, my God, man, what have I gotten myself into? But I went home that night and rewrote the charts, you know, and with some help from my wife, who is a really good sight reader.
Oh, okay.
You know, so
that's
she was
great.
Like, well, this means this, and, you know, so I was able to rewrite the charts and, because what, you know, I think for those guys, man, what's just second nature and just simple, easy, they don't even have to think about, you know, that they've done it so long for a guy like me, you know, I'm like, what does this mean?
Yeah, well, you know, man, I've said it before on this. It's, you know, even though you're not, quote, a schooled, whatever the hell that means, I mean, you feel trumps everything, vibe trumps everything. That's what you have, and that's why people hire you, you know.
Yeah, and
who gives a shit about all that stuff?
And we could cut all that. I don't want to come out sounding false humble. I'm just saying, in that situation, you know, it was okay.
Sure.
You know, it was okay. You know, I was able to. And honestly, one of the highlights was that he had this one song, and this is a little embarrassing because I can't remember the name of it, that he had written with Michael McDonald. And it was, maybe I played acoustic guitar on a couple of songs, but this one had a ton of chords in it, and it was really pretty. And I got to play acoustic guitar on it.
It's on the record?
And it's on the record. And that was probably the most fun thing for me, just to be able to strum.
Or did you just forget how to love me? Just little things would bring us together.
And that was a real thrill because the changes were so nice.
Mm-hmm.
And to be able to play, I love playing acoustic guitar anyway, mm-hmm. you know. And so, yeah, it was a real honor, you know, and we've stayed in touch, and I saw him a couple of months ago, and he invited me down to come and sit in with him one night.
Nice.
It's terrifying because, I mean, dude has
he's a good
he's got a command
of
his thing, man. He has a wonderful sound,
mm-hmm.
too, you know, with that Dumble amp that he uses and whatnot.
Yeah, I've heard of those.
Yeah. There's one for sale.
They're real reasonable.
Yeah, exactly. I'd be honest with you, I've only ever played through one of them one time, and it sounded great. It was cool, but
you know what? There's a guy named Tony Daigle who's Sonny Landreth's the engineer, and I work with him sometimes on sessions, and he's in Lafayette, Louisiana. And I went hang out with Sonny a few months ago at a gig, and I was asking him about Sonny has his Demeter amp, and I said, "Man, what about that Dumble?" He goes, "You know what, Shane? I don't like the Dumble. I don't like the Dumble. You know, Sonny brings that. I can't get a good sound. I can't record that. Don't like it." I don't like it.
Interesting, you know. But you can go buy. There's one at a store here in town right now for $90,000.
Wow.
Yeah, you know.
Yeah, well. I mean, you do a lot of sideman, like house band things. You did the thing with Don Was, you know.
And, yeah, we just
you've
did
done
one.
Several things. I saw you on a thing with Greg Allman once.
Yeah, that was a thrill.
You know, when
yeah.
when you have to learn a lot of things, what's your method? Like, do you write little short?
I write charts. Yeah, I use charts mm-hmm. on those gigs. Mm-hmm. I mean, like on the Greg gig, I had them there as a safety net. A lot of those songs, I had heard a lot.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? And some of them I had played. Have them there as a safety net. We just did a Fleetwood Mac one in New York a couple weeks ago for the Music Cares thing that they do of the Person of the Year around the Grammys, you know. And that wasn't very many songs. But I just like to have the chart in front of me just to,
sure.
just yeah. in case, you know what I mean. Some guys don't, you know, can commit it all to memory, you know. Now, sometimes I do gigs here in town. We have a cover band that plays songs from a specific year in the 70s, you know. So say we're doing something from 1975. I will actually, funnily enough, try to commit most of that to my brain. So, because we're just going down to the club to have fun, and if I'm going to do that, I kind of want to really have fun
right.
and
you
not just be
go.
Glued
yeah.
to the yeah. chart. Plus, a lot of those songs, yet again, I've heard them so much. But yeah, I mean, is that what mm-hmm. when you're in situations like that? I mean, on the TV show, do you use charts?
I do. Yeah, I have like two charts. I have the Daryl's thing going on. There's a teleprompter thing with little cues here and there, but it's pretty much there's no rehearsals, so we have to
right.
have that.
Well, I was going to say, and for guys like you and me, you do so much of these kinds of things, and you know, in different situations, you know, your time as an adult, responsible adult human being. You know, your time is not what it used to be when you were a kid.
Right.
And I got to be honest with you, my capacity for memorizing things, I'm not sure is what it used to be either. You know, it seems like it takes me a little longer, you know, mm-hmm. maybe to try to cram something in.
Mm-hmm.
But I think this is years and years and years of information, you know. So, you know, if you can make better use of your time by using a chart.
Mm-hmm.
In a situation like that, I mean, face it, we're in a house band. We're not doing choreographed,
right.
you know, moves with our instruments or whatnot.
Yeah.
You know, we're just there to try to make the singers,
right.
give them the best bed to sing the song that we can, you know. And so I find that it makes a whole lot of sense for me anyway, just as far as the amount of time preparation. Plus,
yeah.
honestly, when I make, even if I'm going to memorize a song, I always usually make a chart on it anyway because mm-hmm. it just kind of helps
mm-hmm.
me do that.
Play something, man. Just anything.
Sure. What do you think? For?
I could play a little chord progression behind you or something. Give me something.
What makes sense?
tones, baby, play real. It's like a tasty jam, man.
Yeah, man.
That's awesome. I didn't know when you were going to that five chord.
Yeah, it's like random.
It's all good. Riff raff.
With a far away feel, but it makes me feel better.
Didn't you work with Joe Perry too?
Yep, I did a thing with him, man.
Talk about 70s rock, man. You worked with your, you talk
it's
about
it's crazy,
heroes.
Man.
Those
I could show you these. I made these collages when I was a kid, like in 8th, 7th, or 8th grade or something like that, with these pictures cut out of Cream Magazine and whatnot. I've got them around here somewhere.
I believe now it's called a vision board.
Is it really?
It's like a new
that
age.
That needs its own theme.
See, you visualize it, man. It
you
happens.
Need to buy the, I mean, you need to compose the theme music for the vision board. You know what I mean? It was just something that I did to put up on my wall, teenager. You know yeah. what I mean? When I was in 4th, 5th grade, it was all football players. But I could show you one of those things, man. And yeah, and there's a bunch of people on.
So
like,
what was
well,
the thing
I got
with
to
Joe
play with this one, this one, this one, you know. Man, it was his tech, Jim Service, was a friend of mine. And he was just, man, he made a record with him and one other dude in his basement. And mm-hmm. he just needed some guys to, like, do a couple TV shows.
Oh, okay,
and
yeah.
play a couple shows.
Yeah.
And so... Yeah, it was super fun, man. Yeah. It was tripping me out, man. We went through and looked at all his guitars and famous ones. And yeah, yeah.
Crazy, man. Yeah.
That was a long time ago, too. That was right around that Blue Floyd time, I think. Yeah. And so that was, yeah, it was a great experience.
The Blue Floyd thing was fun, man. I think there are some recordings that exist somewhere. I don't know. But
I'm sure
there
are.
We only did like a week tour or something.
Something
like, I don't
like
know,
that was something. Really small. I just remember we finished up in Syracuse and... Wasn't it like the beginning of April or something? There was like 8 feet of snow on the ground or something.
Yeah,
like
I remember
that.
Yeah. You told me the other day you've been with Sheryl for 7 years.
I think this is year number 7.
Sheryl Crow, yeah. That's a great gig.
We started in 2012, so whatever.
You and Peter Stroud. Peter's a great player too.
Yeah,
I know,
he is.
Don't know him really, really well, but I actually bought an amp from him years ago. He's a great player. So
yeah,
you
yeah.
guys. That's a great combo, man.
Mm-hmm.
She's really...
Yeah, it is. Absolutely. It's a great situation. There's some really good songs.
Oh, yeah.
And she can really sing them, you know. And, yeah, so it's good. Yeah, absolutely. We just got back from playing at the Super Bowl a couple of days ago. We did a thing up there, so we got to go to the first half of the game anyway.
Oh, wow.
It was pretty tripped out.
Yeah.
It was pretty awesome. Yeah.
Wow, so that was Sunday. You were up there Sunday.
Yeah, mm-hmm. The last minute thing. And I'm, you know, I don't know why I'm telling you that.
Mm-hmm. You working with all these singers, man. I'm always curious, like, because I work with a bunch of singers. I mean, if you had to give anybody any advice, I've never asked this actually anybody on the podcast, but
man.
Somebody like Sheryl Crow or somebody like Chris Robinson, Rich Robinson, that dynamic, which everybody knows there was a lot of turmoil there at times. Or
well, and Sheryl's there's not.
There's not, but yeah. you still, you know, I guess everything is totally, every situation is totally different application. But is there any advice you would give somebody basically working with a singer? You know, being a sideman, working with a singer, is this, you just...
I don't know. Let's bounce this back and forth because you do a lot of this too. And I think people would be interested to hear both our perspectives on
okay.
it. I would say, first off, just like in the service industry, you know, when they say the customer's always, when I used to bag groceries at the grocery store, you know, the customer's always right, quote unquote, well, the singer is always right.
Yeah.
You know, so you're there to work for them. You know, I'd say if they want your opinion, they'll ask you for it. Do you find that?
If I want your opinion, I'll give it to you.
yeah, exactly. Man, you know, I think that you just got to be prepared, like we talked about. I think it's probably pretty important that you belong there musically, and I don't mean that from a technique standpoint. I mean that from like sort of an empathetic standpoint to what the songs need and what they don't, and really what they don't need, you know, and just do the best job that you can do to, you know, as far as your position in the ensemble. I mean, what would you say?
I mean, no, I would echo that. It's gauging volume for me is always different. Like working with a female vocalist like Madeline Peru, who's more of a jazz singer, going to like Daryl and John, where it's like really loud, and you have to gauge volume and know.
And that makes it a little tricky with our gear too, you know, as you show up, get your stuff shipped somewhere to start a tour or whatnot, and you realize, oh, this is way too loud, this amp, or it's not going to be loud enough because this drummer plays really hard, you know. That kind of thing. So there is a lot there. But, you know, I think that you would agree with this. You know, always err on the side of not loud enough. And that way.
I do, but I've had people tell me, man, you know, like for an audition, just make sure they ask you to turn down. Like turn up loud. Yeah, I've had somebody tell me that once. Which I've never really done that, but. You know, I don't know if that's the best strategy, but you know, here's another thing I forgot to ask you about Frampton. You've worked with Peter Frampton. So you've been in like, man, you worked with Joe Perry. You know, you're in two guitars right now with Sheryl Crow, Black Crows, Jimmy Page. I mean,
it was me and David.
Two guitar things. I forgot about the Dixie Chicks, you and Grissom, man. Yeah. That's a whole nother thing, you know. That's
I learned a lot.
You're a master at like the two guitar thing, man. You know how to weave around people, and you know that's a skill, man. Because most cats just play too much, and it's not about that at all. It's everybody knows you could play. You're on the gig, you know.
I always feel like that if I, you know, I can go down to the bar when we're not out playing shows and play all I want.
Right.
I get a rhythm section and go down there and just play. Right. But. I think coming from where I come from and probably where you come from, I mean, it seems to just be kind of logical.
Yeah.
Does it, to me, you know, I mean, well, I do find that sometimes playing in a studio that you're exactly right that, man, it's just, there's so many notes getting committed to the tape or to Pro Tools, you know, that it would maybe a little breath would be good, but
The studio I think is a lot more revealing. Like less is really more in the studio.
Yeah, you know, and that's
as much as I like Yngwie's quote, "More is more. How can less possibly be more?
Well,
it's impossible." But in the studio, everything gets magnified, man. And, you know.
Yeah, and I think that happens in live, but like you said, it's not nearly as much of a microscope. But I think that. It's such a cliche to say, well, it's what you don't play that makes it. But it kind of, you know.
It's true.
I'm not going to say what you don't play is more important than what you do play, but it'll make what you do play more important.
Sure. Yeah.
You know, and so, I don't know. I think the key word probably is just appropriate, whatever's appropriate for the situation, you know.
I mean, I think people hear phrases in two-bar phrases. Like, they hear hooks in two-bar phrases, one or two bars, like, or whatever that is. You know, boom, da-da-da-da. Those are the things that grab people, and you go, holy shit, that's catchy, you know?
Yeah, maybe so. I never thought about that, you know, on any instrument,
it's like drum beats, too. Yeah,
drum beats, especially. do that.
Exactly. I'm going to butcher this, but just for example.
And
or Celebrate.
Or Evil Woman by ELO on piano.
Yeah,
you're right. I never thought about that. Mm-hmm. Man.
Those are the ones that, never, that seem to.
Oh, dude, I'll talk all day about it.
It's pretty Billy Gibbons-ish. You remember that when you gave me those ZZ Top albums from vinyl?
Yeah.
I still listen to those, man.
It's incredible,
it's
man.
It's best shit.
I listened to it on headphones a couple weeks ago on the vinyl. It's so good. You had him on the show, right?
Oh, yeah. He was awesome. On Daryl's
show. Did you play with him before?
No, I never had.
I got to play with him last year for the first time, too, man.
The Reverend Billy. Oh, you know what, man? Actually, do you remember you gave me that? Was it you or... Somebody gave me that Hertz Cross. Did I give that to you?
You gave it to me.
Yeah, I got that from one of Billy's texts years ago. And I asked Billy about it. I was like, Billy, you remember the Hertz Cross? And he goes, I can't believe you mentioned that. I forgot all about it. I said, I actually have it. I'll email it to you. And he loved it, you know?
Really?
And it's a diagram.
Yeah, I know.
I've
got it. Yeah.
Yeah, the neck with all the frequencies. And I guess Billy would use it to tell the sound guy, you know, dial in some 800 for. What else you want to
man,
redo
I was
something?
Thinking that maybe I should go. I can't really think of anything. I'm sure that this, you know, tomorrow I'll be like, man, we should have talked about this.
Oh,
about
yeah, it's always like that. Now that's going to happen. When we sit there for lunch, I'll be like, oh, shit. I mean, because I didn't ask about Dixie Chicks. I didn't ask.
Right,
there's so much stuff. I mean, if you want to talk
about
you
can't
that,
cram it all into it.
You could, but then it turns up into like 2 hours.
And yeah.
I keep them around an hour and 15, hour and 20.
You know what I like about this, what I really, really like about it is it's not like when guys are putting out a record or they wrote a book or whatnot and they're out on their press tour and they're doing all the podcasts, but they're really like pimping out their thing.
Right.
You know, and this is awesome, man. Just, it's very fluid because we're just having a conversation instead of talking about like, so in the next month or two, what's going to, you know, any of that kind of
making
stuff.
Making the talk show circuit. No,
exactly.
I don't think we're in danger of that. Floyd thing, you had a Dr. Z head that you weren't digging. You liked it, but you're like, man, I already got something like this, and I ended up buying it.
Oh, right,
that,
prescription. What was
Z,
it?
Prescription. And I ended up getting another Z. I have a few of them. I sold a couple, but I sold that prescription.
You did?
I wish I hadn't sold it, but I sold it. And before I did, I opened it up to like, I forget, I took a picture of it or something, and it said in there, made for Audley Free.
Really? Whoops.
So
sorry.
Whoever has that amp.
Yeah. That was a good sounding amp. That's what I can remember. Well, it was a little more blackface fender-y.
Yeah, and I already had two blackface fenders and you know, all that.
Exactly. Stuff. I mean, I don't know. There's so many guys in Nashville, as you know, that know so much about all this stuff, man. You know, I really don't.
I don't know a lot about it either, you know.
Enough to get by, you know, and to be interested in certain aspects of it. You know?
Right.
But I've got people that I can always, hey, what does this mean? You know what I mean? The resources for that are all around us.
What amps are you using right now with Sheryl Crow? You got
man, you know, it's like things have really changed. We were talking about that earlier about guys, please play loud, super loud, like in clubs, you know.
Yeah.
I used to do that. But it's really pretty much low volume.
In-ears?
We use in-ears, yeah. I use, you know, some different things, but usually some kind of EL84 amp, like a Vox style amp. I've got one that guy down the street from, you know, this company called Third Power. You know who that is?
I'm not familiar with him.
You should
check
him out.
Really?
He's got Jamie Scott. He's got a lot of great stuff. And I have this thing that he makes called a Woolly Coats. And basically it's like an AC30, but it's in a Princeton size box. And I just put it on about 3.5. You know, it gives me enough breakup for the sound that I like, you know. And then I got a Fender, one of those Fender Tweed Pro reissues that I just use for a couple of songs if I just need to go. Mm-hmm. You know, if I just got to. You know, if I've got something R&B-ish that needs a Fender
kind of
sound. You know what I'm saying. Mm-hmm. Or something that's really hardcore, you know. You know, we might play something every once in a while that's got a little thing like that. So those, man.
So pretty low wattage kind of things doing the work.
Super low wattage and plexiglass in front of it. And we're on in-ears.
That's good, man. That's good for your hearing.
It's much better for your hearing, man. You know, I will say, you know, when you do hear somebody, you know, every now and then I'll see like Hendrix on TV or something loud, live thing, you know, and it sounds like Godzilla.
Yeah.
I'm talking in a good way.
Yeah.
It's like the only way you can achieve that is that volume that he had. Because the guitar is just vibrating so much, man. You can hear all of it. And the amazing low end and all that Townsend. You know, you don't get that with a little amp, but there's other advantages, you know.
Right.
And so, I don't know. I'll tell you, I did play. They're making a Vox, like 60th anniversary, I think, or something. AC30 and AC15, that both sound real good. I played one of those last week. Sounded real good.
Well, you always get great sounds, man. You got so much great, all the guitars here, killer stuff. So,
it's funny. I was talking to somebody about that one time. It's like you take everything you've got and you try to make it all sound the same. Like, I want this to sound like the way I want it to sound. But I don't have that many amps. I'm kind of deficient in the amps department, so I'm going to work.
You still have
on,
that KT-45? You said you had a KT-45.
Yeah, I got it. Yeah, sitting right in there.
I wish I'd have kept mine. I sold it. I used that on that Billy Gibbons thing. That's a
KT-45,
and I sold it after that. But that was a good amp. It's just so loud, man.
They're real loud, and that used to be like what I would use when I wanted something that wasn't too loud, you know. But I like that. I like a Vox. I like that sound. I like a lot of different sounds, but I do like a nice chimey thing, you know, sort of semi-clean.
Well, right on, man. I think we got enough.
Excellent.
Audley. Hey, I just want to say, Audley, thank you for doing this, man, carving out time.
Man, it was a pleasure for me, Shane. I mean, really, just to get to hang and have some laughs and whatnot, man.
So
I feel
long,
like we
man.
Could talk for five more. I would like to interview you for five more hours.
We'll go have lunch and real stories will come out now. All right, man. Thank you.
Sure enough.
All right, if you're still listening, or if you made it through all that, thank you. Glad you, hopefully you enjoyed it. Thank you, Audley. And tune in next time on the Riff Raff. I have some more great guests coming up. Take care.